Center has a number of resources on the events of 1957 and subsequent. It's butlercenter.org/central60, if you can remember that. If you can't, come to me after the show and I'll tell it to you again. butlercenter.org/central60. And there's a lot of great materials we have, Encyclopedia of Arkansas History entries and documents, including some fantastic home movies that were shot during the events of 57 and thereafter, which, so we're really proud of that. We're gonna get going really fast here, and I wanna ask you to join me in welcoming our partner in this event, Skip Rutherford, the Dean of the Clinton School of Public Service.
Thank you, David. Thank you to the Butler Center. It does great work, and we're so fortunate to have this nice theater in downtown Little Rock, which we use often, and we're grateful. So this is a very special afternoon. There's a lot going on, and my congratulations to the City of Little Rock and the Little Rock Convention Visitors Bureau for putting on a wonderful series of events that leads up to tomorrow at Central High. But today is very special, I think, because it is so unique. And before I introduce the stars of the show today, let me introduce a generation that has done pretty well for themselves, that makes us all very proud. And just remember, forever, they are known as the Little Rock Nine. Ladies and gentlemen, they're all here today. Please welcome the Little Rock Nine. If I didn't recognize someone that we're honored to have with us, because we remember Jefferson Thomas so much and so well, and that is his wife, Mrs. Mary Thomas. Ms. Thomas, we're glad to have you here. We're going to have a lot of fun. This is going to be free-flowing, and as I have told some of the children of the Nine, this is entirely up to you. This is a voluntary. Some may not want to do this, and that's fine. But all of the children of the Little Rock Nine who would like to participate in this conversation, would you please come to the stage? Start by asking each person to briefly introduce herself or himself, tell us a little bit about you and what you are now doing. So I guess we can start, maybe we won't start with you if you want to. Go ahead, buddy. No, go ahead, you got it. I've already called you out, so go ahead and do it.
My name is Whitney Lanier. I'm from Colorado, and I live in the mountains, I work in the mountains. That's pretty much what I do.
And not a bad life, I'm out there, okay.
My daughter is here, Reese is over there. The rest of my family, which is pretty much everybody in here.
That's what.
Hi, everyone. My name is Matthew Patillo, and I'm the son of, one of the sons of Melba Fields. I'm 26. I currently work as a cake decorator, but just finished my degree in graphic design at Dominican University, and I'm looking for my next step. being in the Bay Area has been a blessing because it's filled with diversity, and that's one of the key elements that my mom has tried to instill in me, so yeah. Hello, my name is Evan Patillo. I'm years old.
Hey, Edmund, hold your microphone up. Yeah.
My name is Edmund Patillo. I'm 26 years old, and my mother is Melba Beal. And we are here to talk about how our parents influenced our lives.
My name is Sierra Trickey. My mother is Minnie Jean Brown Trickey. I grew up in Canada, ended up living in Little Rock for 10 years. I'm a proud alumni of the Clinton School of Public Service. I now live in New York, where I work for the Smithsonian.
I'm Ellen Julie Colmar, the daughter of Gloria Marie Colmar. I live in the Netherlands, Parcels in the Sweden, where there's my family lives. It's an honor to be here.
Hello, everyone. I'm Becky Goodloe. I'm the daughter of Terry Roberts. My dad's here, obviously, but my son is also here, PJ Goodloe. Stand up and wave. I have two boys. PJ's the oldest. The other one is not feeling well today. I live in Atlanta, Georgia, and I've been there for a long time, actually. Grew up in California, but now live in Atlanta. I used to practice law, but now I am hanging out with my two boys and running a small business on the side. And it's a pleasure to be here.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mackenzie Green. I am the daughter of Ernest Green. I'm also in the millennial group. I'm 29, so I'm the younger end of our spectrum. I'm born and raised in Washington, D.C., proud Miami Hurricane. Recently graduated from Columbia Business School with my MBA. Was working with a wonderful startup, and we were fully funded, featured in the New York Times, so it was a really great honor to work with that group. And weird fact, I was top 20 in Miss USA about 7 years ago.
Hi, everybody. I'm Adam Green. I'm the son of Ernest Green and the elderly brother of Mackenzie Green here. And I grew up in New York City and have been working as a member of the faculty for the last 10 years at the University of Chicago. I'm a historian of African American history.
Hey, pretty accomplished group, wouldn't you say? Now, I want to take a point of personal privilege before I ask the question, and I learned this from Melba last night, and she has given me permission to say this because she is the mother of two twin boys that you've just met, Matthew and Evan. Listen to this. You talk about legacy. Matthew Thurgood Patillo. Evan Marshall Patillo. How about that? All right, everybody. There is a major national issue. And in the spirit of Minnie Jean Brown Trickey, who believes that activism is with you for life, I want to see if activism is genetic, as hereditary. Let's talk about take the knee. And I'd like to hear your views of what you think about that, and how do you think it's going to play out. And again, everyone doesn't have to comment on it. Anyone who feels comfortable can. If you don't feel comfortable asking a question, just pass the mic. So whoever would like to raise and talk about that subject, I'd appreciate hearing from you. Mackenzie, good for you.
So I was actually talking about this with my dad when it first kind of came up as a discussion post-rally. What are your feelings around it? And so when I was at the University of Miami, I was a sports reporter, and I remember talking to a gentleman who was on the football team, and I was talking to him at the time. It was something really simplistic, kind of an idea on campus that was happening, and students were protesting, and I said to him, do you plan on doing something in response to joining the student body in speaking out? And he said, well, that's not what athletes do. And so then I turned to him and I said, well, are you a fan of Muhammad Ali? And he said, well, obviously, duh, of course, who isn't? And I said, well, you know, he was an activist. He goes, yeah, but everybody really was behind him and what he was doing. And I said, well, that's the funny thing about how history works. When you look back at it from a distance, there's not a single person that disagrees. And I know myself and Andy Young's granddaughter are very good friends, and we love to say to people's children, we always say, you realize that her grandfather, my father, were alive at a time when your grandparents and your parents had an opinion on them that may not have been favorable, that yes, you may talk to them now, and they say, oh, absolutely, I thought the little rundown was a great idea. But have you ever pushed them to ask what maybe their parents felt, what the other community felt? So I think with this take-a-knee issue that's happening is right now people have a strong opinion. You're seeing athletes linking arms with their players. You're seeing Tom Brady linking arms with his teammates but still putting his hand over his heart. You know, I think you're seeing people decide how they'd like to be remembered in black and white images one day, and I hope that our voices, our part of the next generation, our taking the hour, linking arms with our comrades, us speaking to people, will allow us to be on the right side of those voters.
Anybody else want to comment on this?
Okay. Just one thing very quickly, which is that besides everything I think which is really important, Mackenzie said, it's also a simple constitutional question. You have a right to say whether or not you see something going on in your country, something that your government is doing, something that your police are doing, that is so objectionable that you have to say something in public and take a stand against it. And I think that very clear, simple frame is something that comes back to 1957, when the right to go to school was something that was supposed to be constitutionally protected. So it can become complicated, but it can also be made very, very simple. You see rights that are upheld and need to be upheld on the part of everyone who lives in this society.
All right. So let's, you are the children of some very famous people. When did you realize the historical significance of what your parents did? And if you can remember, where did that happen and how did that occur? When did you first realize the historical significance of what your parents did? Becky.
So as a child, a very young child, my dad has, I assume you still have that blue notebook with all the newspaper books. So as a very young child, I would go through this notebook that had newspaper articles and telegrams and letters. And I would flip through it all the time. It was sort of like a photo album almost. And I would see pictures of my dad as a young child. I don't think I knew what it was. I just know that it was part of our family. And in fact, I think I lost something, that a medal that you had won. That you were that Spengarn medal from the NAACP. So I sort of knew that there was something that my dad had done, but I don't really think it became an impact until high school. In high school, my dad was on Good Morning America with Orville Fox, and I think I was a freshman in high school, and watching that was probably the first time I really got what happened. I think I sort of knew and sort of had, you know, people would say, oh, your dad's from Little Rock 9, and say, sure, you know, that, you know, I knew that, but really knowing what it meant was probably high school for me.
Got the time to ask, oh, come on in, yeah, come on, yeah, listen, the board's a barrier here. That's okay, honey, that's all right, come on, we'll just sit right here.
Just scoot in.
Take it to introduce yourself and tell them about what you're doing.
I'm Isaiah Tricky. My sister's there is over there. My mother, Minnie Jean, is out there singing. Isaiah Tricky, son of Minnie Jean Brown Tricky.
And the question, Isaiah, that we're asking the panel right now is, when did you realize the historical significance of your parents? So, got Matthew's answer. Anybody else want to get into this? Okay, Evan and Matthew. All right, y'all can battle it out among the brothers. Who goes first?
So, to me, my mom has always been my mom. And I think the first time I kind of realized she was something more than just my mom was when I was in third grade and I went to our school library. And I pulled out a book called Warriors That Cry. And I saw my mom in the front. And I was like, oh, my mom's on a bus. That was pretty cool. And even then, I kind of was like, oh, okay, so she wrote a book, and I was, you know, really young. And I think then it kind of hit me again when I turned around 8 years old, and we went to the White House, and she got the Congressional Gold Medal of Honor. And then we met the president. And then I realized not everyone gets to meet president. So that was when it really started to kick in. And later in my teens, I started traveling with my mom, really getting to see what she does and what her legacy really meant. And I got it about 17. I was like, my mom was a really, really special person. You know, even though me as a child, like, I just see as a mom, her as my mom, I know a lot of people see her as a lot more. And she's not only a mom to me, but a mom to a lot of other people, a lot of my friends. She's brought into our home and treated like her own children. So when it comes to, like, respect, my mom has really taught me a lot. And so, I think that's kind of like my first, like, I got it was in my early years. So. I described the story a little bit about the book when he discovered it. He actually didn't know it was my mom. He thought it looked like my mom. And then he took it up to her. And said,
oh, my mom didn't say that.
This is what she looks just like you. And then she's like, that is me, honey. Which is actually really funny. I think my first experience with realizing who my mom truly is probably not until my teenage years when you know, I really saw lots of packages of fan mail. You know, she's always been going to interviews throughout our lives, and you know, there's always been, you know, press and, you know, media showing up at our doors. I think I was 9, I saw me go out of my own, like, wrong house. So, you know, I didn't know really who she was. knocked again. I truly think it was around our teenage years when we, you know, were traveling with her and we saw all the other people in schools that were telling us, oh, you know, they were reaching out to her saying, you made such a big difference in our lives just by, you know, writing a book and sharing your experience. And then to be here today, I'm realizing it on a whole other level, just to, you know, even process it 10 years later from the last time I was here, 10 years ago. So I got it then, and I'm getting it even more now.
So a lot of people always seem to think that I knew he was famous, or I'm sure we all say that people think your parent introduces themselves as like, I'm Ernest Green. Would you like a bedtime story? And so I never understood it through the movie, through a fit at the Congressional Gold Medal signing because I was missing a class pizza party. Like, I always felt like it was this weird thing where I was like, this weird thing he does imposes on my life. And I think it didn't hit me until maybe a sophomore history class, and we started watching Eyes on the Prize. And it didn't hit me in a way where I went, oh my gosh, my dad's famous. I went, oh my gosh, I'm gonna ace this class. I was like, I know this. And I remember the teacher, and the moment that really hit me how strange this was the teacher was saying the name of every member of the 9, and they said, Terrence Thomas, I think it was. And I went, no, that's incorrect. And the gentleman looked at me and goes, oh, well, I guess somebody's a savant on one part of American history all of a sudden. And I went, well, that guy in the video that looks suspiciously like me is my dad. And he looked at me like, oh, like, great trick, you know, the one black girl in this class wants me to believe the black guy in the video is her teacher. And I had to beg him to come to school and introduce himself. And even then, the guy looked at me like, oh, yeah, this is really out there, dude. Like, and I think that was the minute it hit me of, I study my dad in classes. Like, people take tests on someone that I complain to. How weird of a reality to live in where all of a sudden it hit me, this isn't something I wasn't studying anymore for African American history. It wasn't something, a Black History Minute that I got to do and I got the grade. It hit me, I am in an American history class learning about 9 people who I call auntie and uncle and that are family.
Others. Anybody else?
Oh, I was just gonna. Is it on?
Yeah,
it's on. Here, I'll take that. So I can't. Did you just switch it
off? Green light, come on.
It's yeah, on. It's on. Okay. Hello? Yeah. So I just want to say I can totally relate to it not really clicking that the person that you're seeing on the cover of a book, or in my case, in a history book, is in fact your mother, even if you see the name written, Gloria Ray. I know that name. But it just, there's something that doesn't click. So when I first discovered who my mother was in American history, was actually just being born in a history class in the Netherlands, just browsing a little bit through my book, getting at the back of the book where the American history was not black American history, just American history. And I saw a picture that sort of familiar, and it was the picture where the nine are sitting. I'm not sure where that was, at the Italian time. So that famous picture, I saw a little girl that looked like my mother, but the strange thing is you don't really, because you don't expect to find a picture that you know in a history book, so then you really click on. I saw the name, and I had to ask fairly easily, Mom, look at my history book. It looks just like you. And that's when I didn't get the full story, but I did get the confirmation that it was indeed her. And I don't think it took until several interviews with journalists before I fully realized that what the full story was. Because like you said, I did not get an introduction. Like, hello daughter, this is me, and I'm a historically significant person. You just live your life. And I think the kids here on this panel, we have a similar experience in that way, that we might have found out in an unconventional way.
I wanted to go after you because I wanted to ask you a question, because the first person who ever uttered anything that I recall about my mother being one of the Little Rock Nine was actually Chelsea Clinton. And it was in 1987 for the 30th anniversary. Like, I had no idea it was Chelsea Clinton. I didn't know who Bill Clinton was. I was a mere child. But I heard that we were like, can we please sleep over? And we were roller skating in the basement. And she actually articulated what the significance of us being there was. So it's pretty interesting because I was wondering if you remember that. Putting you on the spot. Does anybody remember that? Being at the governor's mansion in 1987?
I remember that, but I was a little bit older than you, yes. So I was actually with adults.
I heard you were with Hillary.
I was playing with Hillary. Yeah. She was making me throw sound.
Exactly. That's what it was very interesting to learn from that point of view. I mean, it totally did make sense. I think we have a lot of parallels in the way that we did not actually know, and it was like an ever-evolving process, and every interview or every phone call or the Ernest Green story comes out, and here we have Morris Chestnut, who's the star of Boys in the Hood, playing Ernest Green, and Monica Calhoun, a Hollywood star, playing my mother, and then they were on the Oprah show, and then we were hanging at the White House, And like you said, we're still trying to understand what does this all mean. I mean, especially in these moments, I know right now I feel very emotionally heavy because, this is like, just like the Little Rock Nine, our parents and our families are very connected by this story. I feel very connected to you all just because of the nature of the fact that this is something so painful for our families that they did not. I don't know for what reason, and there are a variety of reasons, share it with us.
And I think something
experience said is so true. It's a club for us too, because yes, it's a club for our parents, but I remember being at the White House and running up to Becky and Spirit and being like, I'm missing a pizza party. And they were like, I know, it's okay, it's gonna be over soon. Like, they understood that in that moment, I didn't want to hear like, yes, Mackenzie, this is an important moment. They were like, I get it. I received this. I understand that this moment feels weird and you don't understand why you got pulled out of your class. But I promise you, you'll be glad you're here, like when you look back at this later. And I started thinking, like, oh, well, if the big girl say it's cool, then I'll be staying. You know, it was just, you know, and the same thing, like what Stuart was saying, like the Morris test, for me, like, I still can never see what people see when they look at Morris, because I'm like, you know, my dad. But it's like, we're in this weird thing that I feel like only when we get together do the other people around you get it, and it doesn't matter how many times people come, because people come up to you and say, how proud are you? And you can kind of give each other the side eye, like, okay, here we go with this moment. But it's like, they get why you're looking at them, like, yeah, I'm really proud, but I still have to go back to, like, work or life or home, or, you know, getting a phone call at 2 in the afternoon. It's like, how do I get my emails? Like, he goes back to being dad. They go back to being mom and dad.
I was coming to, you know, reiterate that, you know, these nine people who raise such wonderful children, truly, we look at them, you know, like we admire, but truly they're our parents. So. They were there to raise us, you know, to put us on timeout, to take things away when we were bad. And we looked at them as though that kind of a role model. And that kind of a role model with such, you know, a strong background, you know, inevitably, you know, rubs off on, you know, some of us. And I think that when people say, oh, aren't you so proud, you know, of your parents and what they've done, yes, we are extremely proud, all of us. We do acknowledge how amazing our individuals are. Parents are, and they've all instilled in us that we have that power too. But you know, at the end of the day, they're mom and dad.
Yeah.
We love them just like that.
Anybody else? Do any of you all recall first time or a time when you had a really substantive conversation with your parents about what happened in Little Rock, the mobs, what happened inside the school? Not just the celebrity status of the Little Rock Nine, but really the details that now over time, thanks in large part to the stories they've told and the books they've written and are writing, we're getting a firsthand view of what went on in the school. Do you all remember having any of those kinds of conversations about what it was really like and some days just how bad it was? Yeah.
I think it was hard for my mom to really tell us all the details of what had happened during Central High School. I don't think that she necessarily wanted us to know everything that happened for reasons of protection and not wanting us to worry. I know my mom has had threats, and I know that the KKK has sent her letters, and but a lot of that stuff I found out secondary, like what really happened to the nine individuals who went to that school, traveling around and seeing my mom's motivational speeches, she revealed a lot. And she was not afraid to tell exactly what happened to a crowd. And by me being there, I got to listen. And her speeches are never the same. So each time she made a speech, I took away something new or was re-reminded that, you know, what she did was important, and I know that she didn't want to scare me, so she's mom first, superhero second, to us.
All right, yes, sir.
So I have never, to my recollection, had a woman-to-woman deep conversation about all that went on there. I think it's because it's extremely difficult, both for me to hear. I'm proud of myself right now, because I'm always in tears when this topic is discussed, and it's painful as a daughter to hear all the details. And I also think that there's, I'll speak for myself, but I feel that there maybe not a big need to share the blackest moments. I think maybe that is something for everyone in the world. We might not share the darkest moments that we have in our life, and it might not even be necessary. You get the story without those. And so no, I've not had that. I don't regret not having it. That day might come, but I feel it's I know what I need to know, and where my mother has felt that she needs to fill in blanks, she needs to understand it better. She has, but no, not
so. Anybody else want to comment on that? Thank you.
That's an interesting question, because we've never had that conversation, and I don't think he had any interest in having that conversation. As a kid, I noticed that my dad never focused on what happened then. He would always talk about what should happen now, all the time. When he comes to speak, he's great. He will come and speak for whatever I ask him to do, which is awesome. He focuses much more on the future than what happened that year. Now, over time, because we get together every 10 years, and for other events, some of the statues were dedicated. I mean, we've seen each other a lot over time. I have learned more when the nine get together and talk, much more. And the last time, at the 50th, when they all got together and started sharing stories, I heard things I had never heard before, either in the press or from them. And it's probably better that I didn't know it earlier. I mean, I don't know that I could have handled the stories. Noble told the story about running to the principal because my dad was being beaten up at the time, and she's trying to tell the principal, come now, and he is just looking at her like, now what do you think you saw? And it just makes you so angry because that's your dad. So I don't know that I could have handled it earlier, and it's interesting to hear those stories, but I don't know that I need to know all the details.
Okay, anybody else? Adam.
Before I say something, I guess I should give a disclaimer. I've been joined by another one up here. I'm not trying to follow Steph Curry's lead.
But you brought the third generation.
If you have questions for the third generation.
Dora can take out her pacifier, she'll answer them.
You know, there have been a number of conversations, I think it's very much along the lines of what Becky was saying, that since 1997, since 2007, since the films, the documentaries, the children got together and did a series of interviews in 2007, there have been a lot of conversations that I've had with my dad, with our dad about this, but I do not remember these conversations earlier, and I think it was very much along the same lines, that probably there was a choice, I mean, my father could say that, to protect us in terms of saying that we don't want you to know what we went through in terms of thinking about the kinds of struggles and the challenges you're facing. But I think there's a different part of this that I would share that was a change, which was that I think one of the reasons why they did that was not only what they went through in 1957, 1958, for some of them 1959, but what they went through for decades afterwards. There were a lot of people that celebrated what they did. There were a lot of people that recognized what they did was something that was historic and was something that transformed the country. I think it's safe to say there were a lot of people that didn't want to recognize it at all. And I recall that the first times that I saw my father being optimistic about the ways that the country was thinking about this, it was about 1986, 1987. Obviously, when Governor Clinton invited the nine to come to the mansion, that was a huge episode. But I remember actually the event that was done at the Eisenhower Library, which I believe was a little earlier than that. And there was a sense that finally some people were coming around and saying, this is history that needs to be upheld. And I remember that having a huge impact on me as a young man, that watching my parent feel that finally what they had done occurred to they had shown as a teenager, was something that was being more widely acknowledged, was something that could actually bring up a different sense of being within the world. And that was for me a time when I began to sort of stop and take a lot more notice about what this meant to him and to the others.
Anybody else? Yes, great. Okay, I'll give you an answer.
So I think what Mel, the title of the book, should say why we didn't know this story, they were warriors, they were soldiers. I think you wouldn't walk up to a vet and say, you know, what was the hardest thing you've ever dealt with? You know, I think asking them, tell me as your child the worst moment that you've experienced, the most pain you've endured, the hardest moment through this now beautiful occasion, what was that like? I think it's impossible for, in a way for us, we'll always learn about it from other people. I've learned about people hanging my father in effigy through Google. I didn't learn about it from my dad. And I don't expect him to ever tell me, because I think, and they can say as well, you know, what they went through, you know, there's a form of PTSD that comes with the pain they endured. So to say to them, you know, to expect them to have taught their children, or to have explained that part to their children, I think they use their pain to help explain the right way to be people. And that is what I know of that conversation.
I have a slightly different perspective because a twist of fate and family and fates brought my mother back to Little Rock for 10 years. And over the course of 10 years, it's something that she, for then 10 years, my grandmother's kitchen table became like a site where we revisited this very traumatic event. Like Mackenzie said, they had a lot of trauma and pain and raw feelings associated with it. So, and then I ended up working at the Central High National Historic Site. So I met and encountered hundreds of people who were personally involved in the story, and I would bring that back to the table. We would talk about it in incredible depth. And I'm assisting my mother to write her memoir, so I've had very, very, very deep conversations about this very heavy story that's a family story, but also, you know, a national story. So I just wanted to throw that out there because I'm so intrigued by the fact that the different variations of levels of conversations or I guess unearthing this or trying to look at it from a different point of view. So I just wanted to point that out. It's just interesting because I've had a very in-depth, and that's had its own interesting journey as well.
Anybody else on that topic?
I'm just gonna add, I think, you know, first off, it's in order to relive that and go through that, especially even with your family, and share that kind of information with your child, it's extremely brave, you know, to even have to wanna, you know, share that intimate, private, horrible life experiences. I think the reason our mother, Melba, chose not to share those awful experiences is because she was very much focused on making our lives and our experience at growing up in a world that isn't perfect as best as she could. I think she was more focused on teaching us the lessons that will move us forward and to help move others forward along with us versus reliving the past and the pain that she lived. We will learn from the lessons, and everyone will learn from the lessons. Inevitably, we will find out, you know, the legacy of our parents and what happened to them. People can cover it up all they want, all the, you know, pain that was happening, but it came out, and we've seen it in many different forms. Our parents really try and make our lives, as every parent, I'm sure, wants to make their child's life the best they can. So I think it's for the nine and their to share their hard experiences, possibly, you know, something that would be difficult. But I have to say that your mother is very, you know, strong and sharing. And you are a strong girl, so she is that, and she is with her, and help her to
arrive. So I also just want to say, because it might seem strange for someone who hasn't lived it, that they wouldn't share their story a little bit earlier with us. But what we also should not forget is these are kids that basically lost their childhood to this, and for them to want to sort of pass that loss of childhood and the innocence onto their kids is, of course, the last thing they want to do. So they want to keep us in whatever our life is like as long as we can without putting that second generation burden on us.
Michael.
One of the things that I've noticed is, and I've heard it from several of the Little Rock Nine at other reunions, that when they come and get together, that they enjoy seeing each other's children and now grandchildren. So we're going to divert a little bit from the program, and I'm going to do something a little unique that it's only going to involve nine people. Only nine people can participate, and you have the right to participate. You do not have to participate. But all your lives, your kids have asked you questions. You know, they've come up to you with questions. Now, to the Little Rock Nine, you have the opportunity to ask a question of the children of the Little Rock Nine. So, I'm going to give you that opportunity. If any one of the Little Rock Nine, this, by the way, I will tell you, this idea came from one of your children. I'm sure. Minnie Jean, don't hate me. So if any of you have a question that you would like the nine to ask a question of the children of the Little Rock Nine, please raise your hand. We'll get the microphone. Oh, Terry, good for you.
Put that.
You're right next.
So here's the question. I've listened carefully, and I've enjoyed every single ounce of this. What is it that you would really like to know that you don't know yet?
Now, listen, y'all got to answer these questions. Parents, not me, asking these questions.
I didn't hear the last part of the question.
What would you really like to know?
What
would you really like to know
that you don't know yet?
What would you like
that we don't yet know?
No, I've always seen, because I've heard it and seen it in such a positive way, reinforced it. I would love to know, if you all got together at the end of the day, like, how many people did you really want to curse out that you did when the day was over?
Anybody else?
I guess we don't ever get to hear about the interaction between you and your parents as much as, you know, because grandma's certainly wasn't saying, tell me anything. So I didn't hear anything from her, and I know she's able to support it. I know everyone has said their parents were amazingly supportive, but really that interaction on a daily basis, how did that work out? I don't know that we ever got that.
Others, anybody else? Give us a microphone.
I know you guys are all so busy at Little Rock Central High, and the seriousness of the situation was great. But you have to have some free time and some happiness on the side. What did you guys do to spend your free time to find happiness as teens?
Good question. Any other questions? That was a good question, but any other questions you got?
Skip, I have.
And then you got an Elizabeth testimony, so go ahead, you're up.
I guess my question is, have you seen this as an assist or as a deficit to your growing up? And how do your friends respond to you as one of the children of the nine?
All right, don't be shy, come on.
Well, I always answer a question. My question was, how do I live up to, or how do I affect change? You know, how do I carry this on? And so it seems like a heavy burden at times, but it's also so influenced by the courage and following the footsteps that I know now. And now it was intangible when I was younger, but it's a little more tangible now.
You know that moment when rockets take off and that first bit at the end takes that boost and pushes the second one up and it falls back into orbit and you see the actual rocket. And it pushes you the rest of the way into space. That's the way I don't have a word for it. But that is a description of how it feels. It feels like every day I get a really great reminder
of what my name means. And when I graduate Columbia and I look over and I see this face that everyone else is looking at for inspiration, looking at me for inspiration, it is the only reason when friends say, what's the big deal? Why don't you want to go out tonight? Grades don't matter. You know, oh, you got time. It is literally the reason some days I continue to push when everything in me says to quit.
We have a question. Listen, that's a question.
Sorry, I didn't know.
That's another word.
Thank you. You have reaffirmed that it was difficult for your parents to talk about the past. I was a very shy person, and the past is very painful to me. But I started talking about it in 1999. By the way, among us, nobody talked about what it was like inside school for 30 years. To do so is to walk through pain. But in effect, I have had my own exposure therapy, and it has helped me tremendously. But the reason that it was so hard for parents to confront this with their own children is because we're going back through a difficult time. So I made my kids watch documentaries. So I couldn't talk about my experiences. And one of them told me that it made him political. I really, really appreciate hearing your perspectives. It has helped me understand better of the impact that it has had on the next generation. Thank you.
Oh yeah, here's Carla. Right.
Yeah. You have to.
Okay, wait a minute.
Well, it is to my son, but also to all of you. I think about my parents, and some of you are with children, and I was just wondering whether what you do know about us, would you allow your children to participate in this activity that the Little Rock Nine did 60 years ago? Mm.
Wow. All right, Whitney, you're up.
That's an easy question to answer. If we had this history, no. I don't know if I'm that strong to watch my child go through that. My daughter is 7, and she was in preschool. I was in preschool for 3 years, and I sat in my car the entire time she was in class every day. There was no way I was leaving her there. Trust me. What was going on behind those doors, I don't know. So that would be a big problem. Our grandparents are super strong. They're going to watch this go on with their child. So no, unless I'm walking behind my daughter to class every day, it probably would not happen.
Others? No, we can do it. Again.
So it's important for me to be straight here, but it's really important for me to be straight with her, so I'm going to have to really be clear. I feel a lot, I think, like Whitney, you just said, that hindsight is a powerful counsel at being moderate and thinking in terms of what's going to be best in the long term for your kids. But
I think that one of the things also that I recall from this, I recall this from, you know, many conversations that I had with you, Dad, was that that would depend on what she wanted to do. That it would have a lot to do with the way that she saw the best opportunities for her going forward. And I might even go a little bit farther and put on a historian's cap and say that part of what was at stake there is, can you be safe in the context of a space that is not going to give you the opportunities that you think you deserve, that's not going to allow you to develop as a human being in the way that you know that you're supposed to and that you have a right to? Or do you take a risk in relation to trying to change something in order to make it possible to be the person that you want to be? And that's a big part, I think, all of us who have kids know, and all of us who have been kids know, that's a big part of thinking about your future, is how can you be more than what you see yourself at that moment in time? What are your ambitions? What are your aspirations? So I would have hesitancy, certainly, but I would listen very, very carefully to what my daughter or either of my daughters were to say as to what it is that they want to do. And if they were strong in relation to saying that this was the path they wanted to take, then my job as a parent would be to support them and protect them as best I can as they took that step.
I couldn't see why someone actually asked me this question. I would support him if he was doing the same thing. And it threw me off. So I'm thinking, would I, if I didn't have this history, would I? Or, you know, I don't know if I would if I didn't know the history. If I was someone who didn't live this history, would I have actually supported him in the same way I would, knowing, definitely would, knowing the history, but would I if I didn't? That's why it's important.
And also in this case, I think, in this case it ended well. Nine kids made it through the school year. And as hard as it is to answer that question now, we're actually looking at the best case scenario, the best outcome here. And I don't know what that says, but I just want to make that point.
Anybody else? Okay, any other questions? Yes.
Well, I'm looking at you, and every time I've seen these children, I keep saying, what magnificent specimens of humanity. And I think I want to say, do you know how much we love you? So Spirit and Isaiah, your grandmother, Minnie Jean's mother, and my mother, when she was asked a question very much like that, she said her children will never go to war, military war. But when my mother was asked about Minnie Jean attending Central, her answer was, she had to do it. So I know. Okay, I don't know.
Okay. Anybody else? Anybody other than
that? I remember that my mother was overly protective and that she was reluctant to give consent to me. That was essential. In fact, I didn't get consent until I came into office. I knew that there were possible economic repercussions for my family. I knew that abstractly. But when I was going to Central, because my mother is a queen of no, I was not sacrificing anything and not participating in extracurricular activities that there were any other school I wouldn't be allowed to participate in extracurricular activities. The queen of no wanted us home with her. But I knew that I could not tell my parents what it was like daily in school if I wanted to continue. So my mother died without ever knowing how horrible it was.
Ernie, here's my question.
But I would say something was interesting about the grandparent that they said yes. I never got to meet my grandmother Green. She had passed away long since before I was born, but I find myself constantly talking to her in moments of trial, because I assume she must have been one tough woman to do that every day, and having to have lost her husband and being a single mom, saying yes to that every day. And so sometimes when I find myself kind of at a loss for word and prayers for strength, I just start talking to her, because as far as I know, she's the strongest woman I've ever met in my life.
We had a break in schedule today and went with my sister out to the cemetery to look at the family tombstones. And I think, yeah, we've said it over and over again, but that the parents really were the backbone of visionaries. I mean, they could see the future. I looked at her name and saw that, you know, here was a school teacher, or here was Jefferson's father, who was a truck driver and a guy in the Jefferson's father was truck driver, Carlotta's dad, Rick Mason. I mean, ordinary people who really put it on the line to believe that one day we could see a group like this, smart enough, tough enough, ready to go forward. You know, I think this has been one of the best panels we've had. So.
And I agree with you on being one of the best panels we've had. I totally agree with that. Let me ask, I want to ask a question that I'm reminded of that great speech that John President Kennedy made that said, the torch is passed to a new generation. In coming years, as your parents exit the stage, and that happens to all of us in the aging process. So not in a bad way, but in a look to the future way, you now are the next generation. And the torch is soon to be passed to you. Do you see this talented group of young people who have walked many miles together and shared many memories together? Do you see yourselves continuing things like the Little Rock Nine Foundation, things like coming back to the 100th anniversary, things like that when people look to the future, that you will be the Little Rock Nine? How do you feel about that and that responsibility that just by your name and who you are, you've got it? So how do you feel about that? Because that torch is starting to burn.
What, the
ad statues of us? That might be the best question tonight. Go ahead, have statues of us. I'm going to leave that one up to Mayor Shackleton. I'm going to leave that. Let her take that one on the cross. No, but I want to talk about, seriously, the torch being passed. Are you ready, and how do you see the role, and what do you see it running down the road? Because this story, one of the things I've found about these reunions, the 30th, the 40th, the 50th, and the 60th, that every time we have this, I know it's great for the nine, it's great for you all, but it is great for history, it is great for a whole new generation of kids who don't know these stories. So if someone's going to keep these stories alive, here we are. So how about that responsibility?
I think it started, it was all about getting education and your the rights you have, the constitutional rights, and to combat ignorance. And I do not feel I would have have the responsibility of being the second generation Little Rock Nine as such. I do feel the responsibility to spread the knowledge and to communicate whatever lessons were learned. Also, what can happen if we do not cherish what we have learned and sort of take. To stop regressing like we've started now in recent years, here and there, and in Europe and everywhere. It feels like we're in a negative spiral. We're seeing history reoccurring. And I feel it to be my responsibility to do what I can to educate and tell my story, my mother's story, going forward.
Others? Thank you.
I agree with Ellen. I think I've already been doing that, and I certainly will continue. When I started thinking about it the other day, what I've done during my life, when I was living in D.C. practicing law, I somehow connected with a high school teacher who asked me to come talk about my dad. And that started a series of events where I would go to a high school, I would show a short film, and then I would talk about my dad's experience, which for the teacher was great because her just standing there talking to the students was fine, but for the daughter of one of the kids in the film to be there made it much more interesting to the kids in the class. And so I've always, wherever I am in life, when I was in law school, my dad came and did a panel. Remember that? He did a panel at Georgetown Law School.
Kids, classes than any group of Americans.
Yeah. But and now that my children are in school, my dad has been the speaker before the kids go to the Civil Rights Museum in Atlanta in the eighth grade. My dad comes and speaks to the eighth grade. So I absolutely see myself continuing that. And part of it is we know a lot about one piece of history. But what I have learned is that in a book, whatever book you're reading, it may or may not be as accurate as the story I know.
Yeah.
And for sure, I still learn all the things that happened. So to me, it seems very important to keep that going and to make sure people understand reading it in one place at one time doesn't mean you have the full story. And you will constantly be learning. And it's a way to get people motivated to keep learning. I'm in a couple book clubs now, and I read books, especially historical fiction. I will do the research after I read the book, just because I'm like, okay, this is what they're telling me, but is this actually what happened? And you know, what is the real story? Partly because I've been involved with learning about the Little Rock Nine, and knowing that you never get the full story in any book. In fact, I've found books where it's just wrong. You know, you have to go back and say, hey, you need to correct this. This isn't even, you know, what you just wrote is not correct. So I absolutely see us getting together in years to come.
Anybody else on this?
You asked the question of are we ready? I don't think you're ever ready. But this car took off long before we signed on, and we are in it to win it. I think, you know,
it's something that you said, it's like you educate yourself on all of it. I remember fourth grade having to do class portraits, and I didn't color mine in, and the teacher said, well, why did you choose not to color in the skin tone of your self-portrait? To which led to a fourth grader being like, I would like to be judged by the content of my character. It's the thing that is in you that, you know, when I'm sitting in a class with a classmate who is, you know, deep Southern roots, doesn't understand it, goes, I don't get this whole Black Lives Matter thing. And I'm like, well, I would love to sit with you over lunch and have further conversation. You know, it's wanting to know that we've done right by them in that way of people don't say, oh, I met Mackenzie Green and God, that kid, you know, or I met the Trickies and
sheesh. You know, it's like you want them to walk away and go, oh, I met one of the children of the nine and I learned so much when I walked away from that conversation, or wow, they really led by example, or wow, I saw them at an event or rally or speaking, and wow, they really inspired my kid or inspired me. And I think that's more the way you look at it. You know, we had the torch before we ever knew what we were holding. And I think, you know, you just kind of, now you start to look over your hand and go, oh, now I get what this is. Now I want to do more with this than just what I've done so far.
Anybody else? Yeah.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say that I wish we were this club, you know, and help everybody. How can other people be so inspired as we are without having to be with each other? We need to find out how we can pass this through, you know, so that people can recognize that you don't have to. I haven't met many other descendants of great activists, and we all have this connection, and we're all inspired by being descendants of these great people, but you shouldn't have to be a descendant to feel this. You should be able to appreciate it. He had a connection. He's like, oh yeah, I mean, I understand. I have the same connection to you just by being with your father. Yeah.
So. There's nobody else that I would rather. There's nobody else that I would rather do this work with than those that are up on the stage and those that are not up on the stage, my sister and others who are children of the nine, who are here, who are doing wonderful things in their own right, and, you know, carry on this work. It's a really serious question, though. I think, you know, at the same time that we say this about our pride in our parents, our pride in our family, our pride in ourselves and each other's, the problem of succession in relation to groups and individuals who have made change is a real serious one. There's a reason why people are able to challenge and refute some of the stories of the civil rights era, because at times we've not done the job that we could in terms of making sure that we were passing on from one generation to the next. And, you know, I have to say, to the credit of all of the nine, there have been conversations over the last, you know, number of years about how we actually do this in relation to the foundation, and perhaps you're bringing up this question, Dean Rutherford, is an opportunity for all of us to really sort of think about how to move that work forward. And I would say also, going back maybe to that answer that I gave before about what I learned from my father in the 80s, as there was beginning to be more interest in this, whether or not the group of us and others are able to, excuse me again, Zora, carry on this work depends partly on many of you here and many more of you who are not here. At the same time that we're here celebrating a great episode of the civil rights era, much of the country is arguing over whether or not the outcome of the Civil War was the one that they wanted to see. And I think we have to understand that as a context within which we operate, that at the same time that we have these great victories and we have these extraordinary figures and leaders and courageous pathbreakers, we also have people who have an idea of this country that is diametrically opposed to what it is that they were fighting for. So a lot is going to depend on whether or not we as a community, as well as we as a familial generation of descendants, are really dedicated to carrying on that work. I think if that happens, then it's possible for any group to carry that work forward. If that doesn't happen, then you have people that are working very hard, and working very ably, but working in a very lonely way to try to carry on the story.
I definitely believe that having such a special, you know, parent, we've learned throughout our lives, just through the lessons subconsciously that, you know, we picked up from our parents, that we have learned a lot about what's right, and also subconsciously ingrained in our minds what it is like to be someone who lives a good life. And I believe that we have a lot of lessons and a lot of knowledge to be able to spread with other people. I do believe it is our responsibility not only to focus on race, but to focus on gender, animal equality, and world equality. I think, you know, they fought this battle. The battle's not over. There's a current battle now, and there's going to be more to come. So I do believe that it is up to us to be able to stay together, to be able to bring our legacy, all the lessons that our parents have, you know, taught and gone through all this, just so we can be their legacy. I want to be, you know, I think all of the children here agree that the nine, you've done so much, and that now you can relax because you've got your back up. We're here to take the torch, and we're here to make sure that, you know, equality is known all around. We're here to make sure that everyone knows about self-love and about how you can't love somebody else if you can't love yourself and how to move forward. So I believe that, you know, I hope to see everyone in less than 10 years, but, you know, if it takes 10 years to, you know, create some big event to make another movement or change to bring light to all the inequalities in our world at the moment, I do believe that, yes, we are here to pass on our parents' torches. We are here to make sure that you guys see the light, that our parents are beacons of hope for everybody. And I think that we're all great people, and everyone does have the power. You don't have to be related to us. We're not blood of Melville. She adopted us when we were 3 years old. You know, she didn't give birth to us. The boy standing with blonde hair right next to her, you know, she adopted him too. These lessons are for everybody, and we're mere radios just to, you know, explain those messages to you.
So for me, I mean, I feel like we all have our different journey and our different way of upholding the legacy. For me, having lived and worked here for 10 years, I literally had to leave it because it was too heavy on my soul. I didn't realize it at the time, but I allowed a lot of access into my personal life in an effort to be the bridge to the next generation. And after a decade, I literally had to step away. So I moved away and I took a position in Seattle. But I felt like the rug had been pulled out from under me. I was like free falling because I was so subconsciously interconnected with this story that it was like a piece of me was missing when I walked away. So I regrouped, I took some time away from it, and I realized that I cannot walk away from it. And I'm back, but I do approach it with a different approach. You mentioned self-love and self-care. There are conversations about preserving yourself, whereas when I first started working at Central, that was not the narrative. We weren't talking about making sure that we're okay in the big picture, in going back into our deep, dark family histories and the trauma that people of color experience. It's not just us and our families, but just think about those folks who are not on the front pages of the paper and the legacy and the impact that had on all of our lives collectively. And I just wanted to say that until I exit stage left, I will be fighting in whatever way possible. I'm still trying to figure out exactly how, but I feel like these are huge shoes to fill, and I feel like we should, to a degree, like, be forgiving of ourselves, because people often ask us, like, don't you feel like it's a lot to live up to? And I know Mackenzie and I exchanged some words on Facebook the other day about how sometimes it is overwhelming. You feel like, how can I ever achieve that type of like greatness or change? And it's not about greatness in terms of the status, but it's more like, I feel a great debt. And I'm still trying to figure out like, how do I carry that forward and honor our parents for their sacrifice, the fact that their innocence was stripped, and still trying to rediscover that. But personally, to my dying day, you will have, and I know we all have it in our own way, but yes, Little Rock 9 Foundation, yes.
One of the great things about this weekend of activities is that there are some very stellar activities. One of the challenges of this weekend of activities is they run back to back, and everybody has to get from one to the other, which makes it sometimes very difficult. We could go on for this one for a long time, but I will tell you that if the question about the torch being passed, I think we got our answer up here, and I think we will. The children of the Little Rock Nine, thank you very much for participating. This was busy time for you, and thanks for making that possible. And to those of you that came, we appreciate you being here. And to the Little Rock Nine, as Minnie Jean pointed out, pretty good group. You all did a pretty good job, y'all. Thank you all very much for coming.